Good morning, everyone. We have a very good video today, this time in Paris. We are with Christopher Thierry. He is President d'honneur de l'AIC and Anne-Marie Villon-Fantini. Some of you sure know who they are, but I think the first thing we have to say is first, thank you for inviting me and letting me do this video and let them tell us who they are. So, Christopher, could you please tell us who you are a little bit?
Who I am?
Yeah.
This is a slightly philosophical question, but I think it might be better if I started by how I started as an interpreter. I was 21 and I had to earn a little money, and someone told me, oh, there's a thing at OEEC, the Organization for European Economic Cooperation, which was in fact the Marshall Plan. It was set up by the United States and Canada to force the Europeans to share half Marshall aid among themselves. It was the first economic cooperation among the European countries. Anyway, so I was taken on by Konstantin Andronikov, who later was to become the initiator and the chief founder of AIC in 1953. But this was in 1949, and I was, after a week, I was sent into a meeting, and we managed as best as we could. It was, of course, in consecutive. There were two of us in the middle of the room. We were scared stiff, and sometimes we knew when the temperature of the room suddenly fell, we knew that the boss, Konstantin Andronikov, had come into the room to listen to us, and that was terrifying. We could sense his presence. Anyway, that's how I learnt to interpret. We were very lucky because most of us hadn't been through a school at all. There were very few schools in those days, and we were very lucky because the delegates were new. They were new to international affairs, and so they were extremely lenient as to the quality of interpretation, which sometimes was brilliant, but sometimes was not. And, well, those were the days. It was consecutive, of course. And later, with the Council of Europe, there was the beginning of, for us, the beginning of simultaneous interpreting. And the first time I went into a booth, I said, but what do I do? I've never done simultaneous interpreting. And someone said, well, you just talk at the same time, that's all, and there's no problem. Anyway, we weren't very good, but we had to become reasonably good fairly quickly. But at the same time, people were kind because they were new to it too. Now, I know that the situation has changed considerably since 1949. And indeed, I was myself involved for a very long time in teaching interpretation later on. And that became the natural way to join the profession. But still, that's how I started when I was 21. I was very lucky.
Anne-Marie, how about you?
Eh bien, moi, j'ai eu un peu plus de chance, je dirais, parce que Christopher Thierry, comme Danica Seleskovic, m'ont appris à interpréter à l'ESIT. Au début des années 70, j'ai commencé ma carrière en 1975, et pour rappeler un petit peu la situation à l'époque dans les institutions européennes, c'était seulement 2 ans après l'arrivée du Royaume-Uni, de l'Irlande et surtout du Danemark, et on manquait certes d'interprètes en cabine française à partir de l'anglais, mais ça existait. En revanche, des interprètes capables d'interpréter en français ou dans n'importe quelle autre langue, le danois, il y avait très très peu de collègues qui savaient le faire, ce qui était pour moi une situation plus que favorable, parce que le jour même de mon diplôme, il y avait un collègue de la Commission européenne, Jean Zing, que Madame Van Hoff avait envoyé à Paris avec des contrats pour essayer de trouver des cabines anglaises, certes des collègues avec l'anglais dans leur combinaison linguistique et aussi le danois. Et comme j'avais la chance d'être la seule avec le danois, ça a quand même facilité grandement mon entrée à la profession. Et puis j'avais eu la chance effectivement d'avoir des collègues comme Christopher, Danica Seleskovitch et Constantin Andronikov aussi, comme enseignant pendant les deux années à l'ESIT.
And we were lucky because we had some gifted but unruly students, such as Anne-Marie.
And the languages, your languages, where do they come from? You had Danish, I mean, is it family languages or did you study abroad,
yeah,
or how was it?
As far as I'm concerned, I was, shall we say, a true bilingual. In other words, I was brought up with English and French in London, in England. I went to the French Lycée, and my father was French and my mother Irish, and so I was brought up with two mother tongues. Now, don't ask me more questions about that, because I can speak for about 6 hours non-stop, and I wrote a thesis, a doctoral dissertation on true bilingualism. But that's another subject which is fascinating, okay. And I'm looking forward to being interviewed by you, madam,
okay,
on the subject
will.
On another occasion.
I promise, you will. And you, Anne-Marie?
Ben, je vais dire la stricte vérité. Moi, j'ai grandi en Suède et je dois dire que le danois est une langue acquise. Mais comme tu sais toi-même, quand on connaît bien une des langues scandinaves, ce n'est pas très difficile d'acquérir une autre à condition d'aller dans le pays. Et comme toi, j'étais à l'université de Copenhague où la Commission européenne avait besoin d'interprètes à partir du danois, et c'est ainsi qu'ils ont envoyé à leurs frais 4 ou 5 personnes de la commission pour acquérir le danois. Et j'ai participé à ce stage, mais on m'avait dit que vous, comme de toute façon vous êtes déjà suédoise, donc on vous paiera pas votre stage. Ce qui est advenu des autres, à part un collègue néerlandais, je n'en sais rien, mais moi j'ai quand même eu mon contrat. Et j'avais aussi la chance que, pour mon premier Conseil européen, le Premier ministre danois était un syndicaliste dont le vocabulaire en matière d'affaires internationales était relativement limité et qui correspondait parfaitement au mien. Ce qui m'a permis de survivre d'ailleurs en cabine entre Madame René Van Hoof et Monsieur Fred Flöschner. Ils étaient par ailleurs très heureux quand je me proposais de faire aussi l'irlandais.
Mm-hmm. And the 50s, the 60s, 70s, how were the interpreters at that time? Profiles, what kind of people were working in the booth or doing consec?
Well, of course, in the first post-war period, most interpreters were displaced persons following the events during the war. And then gradually, there was the school in Geneva, and HEC in Paris, and then ESIT in Paris, and then ESIT. So gradually, the center of gravity moved towards the schools. And I remember when I started in 1949, most people had not been to a school, but then gradually, well, I then taught interpreting at ESIT, and gradually going through a school became the quickest way of joining the profession, though it meant a fair number of years of study, all the same.
Mm-hmm. And you, Anne-Marie, what do you remember of those years, the first years, the colleagues, the style? I mean,
ben, moi, j'appartiens à une génération où je dirais que tous les collègues avec qui j'ai commencé avaient fait une école d'interprète. Certains venaient de Genève et nous étions quand même assez nombreux à venir de l'ESIT. Et je dois dire que la réputation de l'ESIT, de l'école de Danica Seleskovitch, comme on le disait à l'époque, était telle que même ceux qui n'avaient pas le diplôme, mais qui avaient fait les deux années d'études, avaient aussi un contrat de temporaire. On passait un test tous les 6 mois. Et c'est vrai qu'en venant de l'ESIT, on avait quand même une qualité que beaucoup d'autres n'avaient pas, c'est-à-dire qu'on était très fort en consécutive. Et c'est vrai qu'après une bonne consécutive, on écoutait beaucoup moins la prestation en cabine. Parce que, bon, ce qui était important pour René Van Hoof, de toute façon, c'était d'avoir les bonnes bases. Et les bonnes bases, on les avait quand on sortait de l'ESIT.
I would add that it depended a lot on your language combination, because the circuits were completely different. For instance, Anne-Marie is talking about Brussels, which was, of course, a very important entity of the Parliament and the Commission. with a certain number of linguistic requirements. Forgive me, I hope this will be... Anyway, linguistic requirements, whereas I only had two languages, English and French, and the freelance market, and I would say the worldwide market, including the United Nations and Congresses meeting all over the world and so on, was completely different from Brussels.
Of course.
Brussels was became a much bigger market, if you like, but the circuits were different. But for example, when I started by being permanent at OEC, and then for 1 year permanent at NATO, and then for 17 years I was a freelance and did a lot of recruiting myself, but that involved a lot of travel. And I remember that fairly soon I had traveled 6 times around the world for various congresses, because in those days, if you had a contract in Japan, you could come back the other way, and so you could go around the world.
Okay. Yes.
That was quite an art. And so the outlook was quite different from Brussels. For instance, I was hardly ever recruited in Brussels, because with only 2 languages, that's not important, that's not useful. It was only during I worked in Brussels during the negotiations with the British, because it was useful. But otherwise, no. I was very offended. I was never recruited. So,
you said something very interesting, perception. Do you think interpreters were perceived in a better way at that time than, not now, but I mean, if you think throughout your career, do you think that perception has changed?
You mustn't think that we were considered as to be freaks, and people doing a strange thing, and they were therefore people to avoid, performing monkeys. We were treated, or parrots. We were not particularly well treated. It was not considered to be a good thing. It became a good thing with the United Nations and the interpreters in the booths. And often people said, oh, you do simultaneous like the United Nations. I said, well, I do that, a number of other things too. But don't think that in those days the interpreters were considered to be respectable people. Uh-huh. They were not, really. But and it's thanks to AIC, to a great extent, that as a profession, that we became to be considered to be reasonable people. And for example, when in 1950, when was it, 7, I think, or we first decided that, well, AIC decided that the UN freelance rate should be increased from $25 to $30. At first, I went with Andronikov. I was executive secretary at the time, and we tried to get an appointment with the UN and UNESCO and so on, and we had great difficulty. And we were told we don't talk to the freelance gang, or we were considered to be disreputable people. And it was only when we won the first battle with UN, mm-hmm. Simply by people accepting a contract, but only at the new rate, that we became respectable people in the eyes of UN, because as they had given in to us, they had to consider for their own hierarchy that we were respectable people, obviously, because you wouldn't give in to people who are not respectable people. But in those days, don't think that we were considered to be little gods, because we were not.
Okay.
And I would say that nowadays, interpreters are probably better considered than
really?
They were at the beginning.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What do you
think? I beg to differ. Et Christopher, est-ce que tu as quand même vécu des moments où des clients t'ont demandé si tu étais disponible avant de décider de la prochaine réunion? Parce que même moi, pendant les années 70, ça m'est arrivé avec certains clients qui voulaient avoir certains clients pour qui je recrutais, par exemple, où on disait, on va demander à Madame Vidlund si son équipe est disponible avant de décider, choisir entre le 17 mars et le 24 mars. Ça, tu as dû vivre ça quand même.
No, quite honestly, I don't remember that ever happening to me, but we were certainly considered to be very or even important people by the people we worked for, by the Federation of, I don't know, of
manufacturers. C'est ce que je voulais dire.
They considered us to be useful because they knew the difference. They had learned the difference between a professional interpreter and someone who was not.
Mm.
But in the world at large,
ah oui, d'accord,
we were not considered to be particularly important people. They said, oh, well, why aren't you a journalist instead or something? Journalists were considered to be good people. That's we were not.
Non, pour revenir à quand je disais que je n'étais pas d'accord avec toi, je voulais dire les clients, les okay, clients pour qui
let's
on
talk
travaillait.
About the social status.
Ah oui, non, bien sûr, non. Ils savaient même parce que c'était quand on disait qu'on était interprète, les gens demandaient tout de suite combien de langues savez-vous.
Oui,
et si tu avouais que trois langues, t'es tout de suite considéré comme un moins que rien. Oui. Et toi, avec seulement deux langues, franchement.
But I mean those decades, the 60s, the 70s. I mean, would you say they were the golden age of the profession?
Well, I don't know because yes, in a way, rather like les Trente Glorieuses in France. In a way, I suppose, because people did need interpreters. For instance, in Paris, scientific congresses were interpreted in three or four languages. Now they're not interpreted at all, or they're in English anyway, bad English, but English. But so in those days, yes, it was a golden age to a certain extent. I'm not saying that there isn't going to be a golden age in the future, but it will be a different kind of gold.
Yeah. What do you think, Anne-Marie?
Ben, quand en 1975, on s'est entendu dire, nous les nouveaux diplômés, donc à l'ESIT, on s'est entendu dire à la au cocktail qui a suivi le diplôme par nos aînés que c'était, vous savez, c'est fini, vous n'allez pas. Ça n'a rien à voir avec ce que nous avons vécu, par exemple.
Ouais. Mm-hmm.
Et moi, j'aurais tendance à le dire maintenant, mais c'est, comme dit Christopher, de toute façon, c'est une profession qui a dû s'adapter.
Hein, in any case, yes, you're perfectly right that the people graduating, even from a good school like ESIT, had difficulty during the first year or so in making a living. It's never been easy, but it's probably, I don't know, more difficult now. Mm-hmm. I can't judge.
Yeah. What about English? I mean, there are so many meetings. I mean, you said it. So many meetings just in English. Do you think English is killing us?
But well, it's not English.
English or Globish? I mean,
Globish. Yeah.
It's certainly reduced the number of cases where interpretation is required. Mm-hmm. At any rate, I don't think it applies all that much, though it may apply to some extent in the European institutions. It hasn't changed all that much in the big international organizations like FAO, WHO, or UNESCO, though to some extent it has, but not that much. It certainly has changed the freelance marketing rate in Paris because, as I said, there are very few, scientific or medical congresses with interpretation now. Incidentally, the funny thing is that if Hitler hadn't decided to kill all the Jews, the chances are that a lot of Europeans would be speaking German now. Because German before the war, especially before the First World War, was the scientific language of most of Europe. To be published, it was better to write in German than in any other language. Mm-hmm. And this everyone has completely forgotten. And Hitler wiped that out by sending all the Jews to where we know.
And Marie, what do you think is going to happen with the small languages, minority languages? Do you think they're going to disappear for interpreting?
Moi, je pense que de toute façon, au sein du Parlement européen, je connais mieux la situation du Parlement européen, évidemment. De toute façon, je pense que on sera obligé de garder toutes les langues, parce qu'on ne peut pas dire à un Polonais ou à un Slovène qu'il n'est éligible que s'il maîtrise une langue étrangère, hein, parce que ça ne serait pas démocratique. En revanche, je ne pense pas du tout que l'interprétation dans 10 ans ressemblera à la situation d'aujourd'hui. Comme j'ai déjà eu l'occasion de dire, je pense que de toute façon, les Chinois, les Arabes et les Russes ne vont pas se mettre à un autre niveau en apprenant le français ou l'anglais. Je pense que on aura toujours besoin de, peut-être pas de Slovènes ou Roumains français, mais Chinois, Anglais, Russes, Arabes, Anglais, je pense que de toute façon, il y a beaucoup d'avenir.
And always both ways, every tour thing.
Ben, je pense que de plus en plus, oui, les gens sont obligés de faire un retour. C'est ce qui s'est passé à partir de 2004 au Parlement européen, où évidemment, c'était pas possible. À partir de 1995, ça commençait avec le finnois où il y avait effectivement personne dans les autres cabines qui maîtrisait le finnois, et c'était les interprètes finlandais de langue maternelle finnoise qui assurait le retour vers une autre langue européenne.
But I think that's peculiar to the European institutions.
Tout à fait, tout
à fait. I think the rest of the world, I'm personally convinced that there is a future for conference interpreting. I'm not sure that the language combinations will be the same as the ones that are in demand or that were in demand or that are still in demand to some extent at present. But as Marie was saying, the Japanese aren't very good at English, and I don't see the Koreans neither, and I don't see the Chinese, and as you say, all the other countries suddenly all speaking Globish. I think it's part of the way the world is changing, and I think there will be room for professional conference interpreting. And also I'm impressed with the amount of interpreting, not always very successfully, but that there is on television. More and more national programs show videos from other countries and so on, with someone speaking. Now, they aren't all professional interpreters, but some of them are. And it's a good thing. I think there is a future. In other words, I'm sure that there is a future for the profession, but it will necessarily have to adapt.
So, you think there's a future, a different future, but some kind of future for us?
Very definitely. Yes.
Yeah. Pour de bons interprètes, si je peux me permettre d'interjeter ça, Danica Seleskovic disait en son temps que l'interprétation doit être bonne, sinon c'est inutile. Et je pense que de bons interprètes vont continuer à trouver leur place dans le monde de la politique internationale et aussi au sein des institutions.
If a student, someone doing languages, wanted to become an interpreter, what would you say to him or to her? Someone who's 22, 23 years old, thinking of doing a master's degree or something related to interpreting. Would you recommend this career to them?
Ça dépend de sa langue maternelle.
Well, yes. As Marie says, it depends who is... I get people asking me that precisely that question. Even someone who was age 15 wrote to me last week saying, I'm interested, what should I do? It's difficult to say. I think the first thing to remember is that professional conference interpreting requires a fairly high degree of, academic study. And it means that you have first to do something else. You have to learn something, some other subject that you're interested in. And you mustn't start at the age of 18 saying, I'm just going to learn interpreting and nothing else. You have to start reading, science or vegetarianism or law or God knows what, something which you're interested in. And then, after 3 years, you can then perhaps apply to an interpreting school and perhaps luckily get accepted and then become a professional interpreter, but you will have brought to the profession more than just your knowledge of language. That, I think, is very important.
Anne-Marie?
Ça dépend de la langue, comme je disais d'entrée de jeu. C'est pas sûr qu'on ait besoin de cabine grecque avec l'espagnol, le suédois et l'anglais, et c'est pas sûr qu'on ait besoin exactement des mêmes combinaisons linguistiques. Mais je demanderai d'abord aux jeunes quelle est sa combinaison linguistique, et s'il a 18 ans et qu'il vient de passer le bac, et c'est que c'est là qu'il va commencer à apprendre les langues, je dirais que c'est trop tard. En revanche, s'il a des connaissances de langue où il est peut-être rare, c'est peut-être une combinaison linguistique plutôt rare, je pense qu'en faisant d'autres études avant, comme dit Christopher, en faisant une licence ou une maîtrise de droit ou de sciences, que ça peut être une bonne idée, mais il faut savoir exactement quelle est
sa... I'm going to interrupt because I agree, but
exprime le mieux.
Someone very young asked you that question, and what they often do ask is, what language should I specialize in? I would say, well, Chinese, to start with, because I'm sure there's going to be a demand.
Absolutely.
For interpreters. I mean, there should be, in view of the size and importance of China.
Tout à
fait
d'accord.
Chinese would be a good China, and I mean, Russian too. And so you have to look at things differently and try and imagine, if someone is young, what the future is, the world is going to look like in 20 or 30 years. And there, your guess is as good as mine.
Well, I don't know. I think yours is better. And to finish, you've had wonderful careers, both of you.
Yes, because we've been very lucky.
Lucky?
Oh, yes.
You
luck.
Think so?
Oh, yes. Well, one day I was with President Chirac in New York, interviewed by, what's his name, Larry King.
Larry Live. King.
Larry King Live. And they were sitting opposite each other, and I was next to Chirac, but off camera, just in case he needed a word, and he did actually need a word, which I was able to supply. It was about the atom tests, nuclear tests, that had been resumed in Muhoroa. But Chirac wanted to say that they weren't going to last very long, and suddenly he said, comment dit-on printemps? So I was able to say spring. So I was known as Mr. Spring from then on. But before we started, Larry King asked me, how do you become interpreter for the French president? And I said, by luck. And I think that was absolutely right. It's the first thing that came to me, because I've been very lucky, we have been very lucky, and other people are still lucky nowadays. I mean, luck hasn't disappeared, but I think a degree of luck is important. Mm-hmm. I could give you numerous examples of how lucky I've been, but that would be another subject.
For another video. Okay. Yeah. Anne-Marie?
Oui, je dis, moi j'ai vraiment eu de la chance, parce que si j'avais eu que l'anglais et l'allemand, anglais, allemand, espagnol ou anglais, espagnol, je me serais heurtée immédiatement à un certain nombre de collègues qui ne m'attendaient pas sur le marché parisien.
Oui,
j'ai eu la chance qu'avec...
Yes, but being brilliant, you would have made your way all the same.
Non, pas du tout, parce que vraiment, je n'ai vraiment fait de l'ombre à personne. Ça, c'est quand même...
I think she's being over-modest, quite honestly, but still, I mean...
Mais toi, Christopher, tu étais quand même le seul complètement vrai bilingue à ton époque.
I wouldn't say that, but I was lucky in being...
Un vrai bilingue, voilà. Et tu étais le meilleur aussi.
Well, I was also very lucky, quite by chance, I was dropped into a profession which suited me, and I was good at. And I've been very lucky in that. But that's luck. It's thanks to being bilingual to some extent, and also for some curious reason. I mean, people often ask me, how does one become a good interpreter? Can you tell beforehand? And I would always answer, especially when I was head of interpreting at ESIT, it would be very useful if we could tell beforehand if it's worthwhile for this person to spend 2 or 3 years trying to become an interpreter. But there's no means of knowing The only thing that I answered was that all I do know is that the people who fail to pass into second year, for example, and who do not become interpreters, it is because they are incapable of expressing exactly what they mean in their own language. No, it's not a question of knowledge of language, but it's a question of frame of mind. You have to be capable of saying exactly what you mean and not almost what you mean.
And don't you think that's a problem nowadays with the new technologies and WhatsApp and all these small messages? People can't express what they feel and what they think. It's very difficult to get someone with a...
Well, that's a question which I ask you. You know far more about
all this. Yeah, but I have an impression that it's like we can't. I mean, people have problems.
Well, it's a very good question because it's very serious if people lose the habit, because it's a habit in a way, and it's also a frame of mind. To being precise, but I don't believe, quite honestly, that there is a real danger, because there will always be people, luckily, who basically consider that it's a good idea to say exactly what you mean and not what
helps. Anne-Marie, something to say?
Moi, je dirais que un grand danger, c'est le fait que les en tout cas les parlementaires européens n'ont pas le temps de parler. Ouais. Donc ils lisent des textes. Et la même chose est vraie pour les congrès médicaux et les congrès internationaux aussi. Mais je pense que, quand, tu le sais mieux que moi, en plénière au Parlement européen, quand on te donne un texte, tu vois que c'est un texte qu'il te faut 3-4 minutes pour lire et le bonhomme qui présente le texte, il a 45 secondes. Donc c'est quasiment impossible. L'interprétation, c'est quand même... La parole que nous et une pensée qui se développe, mais là il n'y a pas de pensée, il n'y a pas de parole, tu n'entends même pas.
Yes, as Danica said, when you speak, the thought precedes the words. When you read, the words come first, and if you're lucky, the thought will come too.
Elle disait aussi, quand vous parlez votre langue, vous pouvez dire ce que vous voulez. Quand vous parlez, vous exprimez dans votre langue B ou n'importe quelle langue étrangère, et tu dis ce que tu peux.
So thank you very much for dedicating me this morning to talk about all these things. And I know I have to come back to do that video and we can do more things together. Thank you very much.
Très volontiers.
Well, thank you. It's been a great pleasure.